contact you. I'm not putting you on any email list or anything like that, but you've got to put your name so we can contact you.
What about your personal email list?
Social Security
yes,
number?
Yes, I will send you my my Pinterest
boards. Your board, your search shared Pinterest boards. Board.
Yeah, so so that's what you got to do. You got to go to there, but we got to hit those milestones. So even if you've been a subscriber before this whole time, for the last 10 years, that's wonderful. But you got it. We got to hit those milestones. So you got to get your friends to sign up. So please, 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 please do. Please do. And you can cap. I will give you even more commercials because that's what pays the bills. Here's a commercial for you.
Wait, are you serious?
Yes. The lovely Zach Melton in the middle of a throw. I just saw this picture and I thought it was cool. So I wanted to show everybody. No, we don't have fans of Zach Melton. What about Mr. Eric Oakley? Would they enjoy a felon throw of Eric Oakley?
It seems like they don't really want to see any commercials right now. I'm not sure. It's tough to tell, though.
It's tough to tell.
Yeah.
Let's see. Okay. What else we got going on? That's it?
That's it. For now.
All right. Let me start the actual show.
We should really go live.
We've got some picky people today.
Well, they were saying the commercial audio played really loud over the event flyers while it was supposed to be us. Yeah.
My B. That's my B.
Whoops.
All right, here we go. We're starting the show.
Let's start the show.
We are starting the show.
Are you interested in starting the show?
I am very interested.
Okay, let's get it.
Hey, everybody, welcome to this episode of the Disc Golf Fans, man. I am Bobby Cool Daddy Slick Breeze. I have with me Robert Smirky Smile McCall.
What's up, man?
Eric Chiefs McCabe.
Go Chiefs.
Go Chiefs. We are here on Tuesday, September 17th for another episode of the Disc Golf Fans, man. Hopefully you joined us yesterday for the Dynamic Discs updates with Jeremy Rusko. Jeremy was able to share a lot of good information. So make sure if you haven't checked that out, make sure you go back and check that out. I'll see if I can, for our audio listeners, see if I can turn that into audio. We looked at a lot of bags and some carts, so you won't be able to see that obviously in the audio version, but you'll be able to get some good information. So I'll see if I can put that out. How are you gentlemen doing?
Man, hanging.
Good. Hanging in there?
Yeah. I don't feel really great today, as you might be able to tell from my voice, but we out here.
Did you catch a cold or something?
Yeah, or just allergies or something.
Probably allergies.
Mm-hmm. Mm. Alas.
Alas.
We are
out. I played some disc golf this weekend, first time in I don't know how long.
Where'd you play at?
Peter Pan Park.
How'd that go?
Really well.
When did you play? We played Peter Pan.
Yeah, thanks for the invite. Man,
yeah, thanks for the invite.
That wasn't me. I was invited.
That wasn't me. You were there playing. Yeah, that wasn't you. Yeah. Whatever.
My phone stopped working for the 2 hours I
went. Wait a minute. You did invite us to your...
That's because I already knew you played. Like, why would I invite you to a round after you just played? You barely played one round a week.
Yeah, you suck.
Because I saw it all over Instagram. My real friend...
You're not good at sneaking around.
My real friend, Anthony, hit me up and asked me to play disc golf. No. We went and played around. What's up, dude? We went and played Peter Pan on Saturday afternoon after both of us went to the Great American Market.
Oh, did
like
you
not
anything?
Together, but we went. Oh. Like I went, and then I went. Sure, we're not that close, but
yeah,
we bought a nice, cool little table.
Nice,
yeah, made out of bald cypress and eastern cedar.
I saw a picture of that.
Yeah, it's
really
cool.
It's
really cool.
Yeah. Yeah. I actually played some disc golf this weekend also.
Nice.
First time in a while.
Me
Where
too.
Did you play?
I went out
Peter
on...
Peter Pan, Saturday evening.
Thanks for asking. I actually did go to Peter Pan, but it was on Ooh. Friday.
Ah.
There was a gentleman that I met at the Toonie last year.
Yeah. That's so
Finland.
Crazy because I went to Radius that night.
And he was
Friday
there.
Night. And we were waiting on... Because they... I mean, this is going to take a little while, but they had halibut on the menu.
Nice.
And anytime they have halibut at Radius, you go to Radius and eat halibut.
Yeah, you gotta go.
We went Friday, we're waiting, and obviously it took forever to wait. And this guy came up and goes, "Eric, right?" And I go, "Yeah." He goes, "I met you in Finland last year." And I'm like,
Yes,
you did. It's just so random to meet somebody at Radius that you met in Finland last year. So
yeah, he reached out that they were he and one of his business partners, Jenny, were traveling around the country and
with margaritas?
With margaritas. Now, this is actually a different Jenny. Wanted to, come to Emporia and check it out. So I played a round of disc golf with them on Friday morning. I gave them a few tips, and then we just, played and had fun. Went over to the retail store and Seem like they really enjoy themselves. It was super cool.
Very cool.
It's awesome. Yeah. Very cool. Very cool. Yeah, I played some disc golf on Saturday morning with Jeremy Rusko and some people from 515 Vapor.
515.
515, yeah. Brandon Butler, I believe the name is. Mm-hmm. And I had a good time out there and then went to the Great American Market. That was really cool.
Did you buy anything?
Yeah, thanks for the invite.
I did not buy. Tacos? I bought tacos.
Yeah.
I did buy some
tacos. Nun tacos.
I bought some nun tacos.
Gosh, and then, they're so good.
Then thanks took for the invite home. For tacos.
I cannot. Okay, you guys have who have been to GBO know how big that block party is.
Yes.
Well, Great American Market was twice as big as that, as far as the length goes. Yeah. It was ridiculous.
There was a lot of people out there.
Yeah, it was awesome.
I did tell you I was going to Great American Market. So
I do not remember that
was open.
That does not sound familiar to me.
Yeah. Right, so I had that, and then I had, and then for to take home, I took home some street tacos and had those as well.
Yes.
You took them home, or did you eat them there?
I ate the nun tacos at the beginning of my journey. I went all the way around the Great American Market.
My journey.
And then I thought,
by the time you were done, you got more tacos. That's how big this Great American Market is.
Yeah, and then I took them home, and I sat, and I thought, I'm just going to eat them right now.
Yeah, that sounds like the play.
I don't blame you.
All right, let's get to some disc golf talk, some disc golf questions. What do you guys say?
Yeah, all right.
As always, you can go to discgolfanswerman.com, submit your disc golf questions. Guys, we are sitting about 100 questions in the queue for the Google Forum, which is awesome. Thank you so much. But just know it's going to take a little while to get to your questions.
Yeah.
Oh, no. First, sorry. Before we get into it. Well, no, let's get a few questions and we'll talk about it. So
okay.
He'll do that.
This is from Jake L. He says, I have been just starting with backhand this year, forehand 10-plus years, and I have been able to get my EMAC 300-plus with a straight flight.
Yeah, bro.
Yeah. Fairly recently, I noticed all of my shots are hyzered and not straight, even after trying to keep a flat release. Could something with my form timing be causing this?
Probably so.
Most likely.
That's generally the root of missing your angle, kind of like that. Without really seeing you throw, it's hard for us to know. If you're throwing your EMAC dead straight, 300 feet, it shouldn't be that you have, you know, like bad form, or you're throwing the disc nose up or whatever. That's fantastic. I think that probably the best thing that you could do is go to the Disc Golf Answer Man Facebook page and submit a video of yourself throwing backhand, and we'll see what we can check out from there. Mm-hmm. You might also try to overcorrect and just see what that does for you. Try to start throwing a lot of things on super Anheuser.
Yes.
Just to feel what it feels like to throw an Anheuser again.
Because most people think that they throw flat, but in reality is they actually throw with slight hyzer. Yes. Like for me personally, whenever I feel like I'm trying to throw a big turnover shot, I'm most likely still releasing with a little bit of a hyzer.
Yes.
So
I agree. So yeah, maybe over exaggerate that Anheuser and then see if you can find the middle ground.
Mm-hmm. All right, next one comes from Dynamite Jackson.
Dynamite.
Dang, I want that to be my name.
Dynamite. I have a small child, about 3, on July 22nd. Happy birthday. Shout out to Eleanor. I'm dying to get her involved with disc golf and get her out on the course with me. Obviously, I'm a ways off from doing that. Is there any advice you can give with working with her as she gets older to get her to that point? Right now, I have a couple of baskets and plenty of discs in the yard. We just kind of mess around, but she at least knows where the disc goes. You guys are great. Love what all you do. Thank you. Hi, Weston.
Hi, Weston. I don't know what you say there. You rock.
I mean, it depends on how old. I mean, I'm not very good with like knowing ages of kids and when to start implementing more and more technique into it, but sounds like she's off to a great start, at least knowing where the disc goes. And the big thing I can say is don't force it. You know, at first, at least let it come natural. Let her want it, as opposed to just really forcing everything onto her. But obviously, just keep doing what you're doing and just make games out of it and have fun and lose to her more often than win to her, if that makes sense. Like, don't be that dad that just beats him down every time.
Well, turns out I won by 40 again.
It's like, I won. Get out of here, you know. Do the dishes, that kind of stuff. But
go do the dishes.
But,
you got to take out the trash this time.
Just make sure that she's having fun. And if she continues to have fun, she will continue to love the sport.
Yeah, I mean, I think that's, as fun as it can be. Mm-hmm. That's really all you can do.
Someone threw in some knowledge, said sustained interest starts around 6 to 8.
Perfect.
Nice. You dig that.
So All right, Raymond asks.
68. Playing... I can't wait to right. get there.
Wow. For things to start someday sticking,
you're
huh?
going to reach.
Things are going to start sticking things at 68. Raymond's been playing for 8 months now and decided to switch to a full DD bag. Way to go, Raymond. Everybody Raymond. Loves Raymond. bag the sheriff, but having issues with deciding between trespass and the raider. It seems to fly the same for me. But is an EMAC trespass one? Thanks for signing it, gosh. Mr. McCabe.
You got it.
Also bagged the defender. If you guys help me decide, I feel like I am too new to really decide. By the way, I measured my throw with a distance wheel thing, and it was both around 425 to 450. Thank you very much.
Solid.
That's really interesting if you're throwing 425 to 450 that the trespass and the raider are doing the exact same thing
agreed.
For you.
No, agreed. Yeah.
That's very interesting.
Because of what trespass. Now, I could see the mm-hmm. Lucid X trespass and the raider yeah. flying.
Straight out of the box.
Very similar.
Yeah, to each I agree. Other. Yeah, that's strange. Yeah, I don't know. I do think if you are throwing that Lucid X trespass, it is going to be a little bit more overstable out mm-hmm. of the box. Maybe not even a little bit. Maybe
it will be overstable.
Quite a bit more overstable out
correct.
Of the box.
Correct.
But at that distance, you should definitely be seeing some difference between those two discs. What was the tail part of the question, Bobby?
That he asking just advice on discs.
Help
I guess,
me decide
which
I feel
between
like
the
too,
two. Kind yeah. of because oh. the Raider and the trespass are very similar.
I guess they do feel different. In your hand,
I would say whatever feels better in the hand. If you're getting similar flight out of it, at the end of the day, it's all about comfort.
Yeah, I mean, yeah, I prefer the Raider for most of my distance shots, but I keep a trespass because for me they fly quite a bit differently.
Me too.
So,
gotcha. All I right, do. Let's Smaller head on over rim. To Speak yeah. Pipe. Speak Pipe.
Hey, Disc Golf Answer Man crew, this is Chooch Charlie, Pottstown, Pennsylvania. I got a footfall question for you. I noticed that when I'm taking a field shot, you know, like, so second shot, I'm doing a run up and I'm either behind my disc or I'm behind my marker. I plant my foot, I take my throw. And as I rotate on my heel, I have hit my marker or I've hit my disc and even pushed it out of the way or rotated over the top of it. And I'm wondering, is that a foot fault? Like when do you have to be behind your lie or you take your lie? And then when can you pass your lie and affect your marker and that kind of thing? Is there a legal PDGA thing to it or just an opinion? As always, keep it real. Thanks for what you do.
Foot fault.
Second.
Ooh, that's a stroke penalty now.
That is?
but you take the shot.
Yeah, sure. You do not have
is
to
Is it as simple as that?
No, it's not a foot fault.
No, it's not a foot fault at all.
So we're gonna go to we went to one of our blog posts here, but so here it is. Our lie rule changed in 2018.
It did.
It changed from a direct line right behind the basket. If you draw a direct line from the basket through your lie, or if you're if there's a man on play, it's a little bit different. But straight through the disc. You had to be, at that time, within 11 inches of the back of the disc.
Which is almost the size of a disc.
Yeah, pretty darn
roughly
close.
Roughly a disc length.
Right. Now, we do, we have a 20 centimeter by 30 centimeter, kind of like, if you think of a piece of paper, it's about like that behind the disc that we can step when we throw. Mm-hmm. So, your question about stepping too far behind the disc, you can definitely step too far behind the disc if you are 30 centimeters, and 30 centimeters is a foot, by the way, it's 12 inches. It's very close to that, right? If you're behind that, yeah, you could be called on a foot fault. Most people are going to be less likely to call that unless you're way behind it or way off to the side or whatever. But the way that you would be called on a foot fault a lot of times is if you step on your disc because you're already past your lie at that point. Now, if you're in the field and you plant behind the disc, you get ready to throw and you release the disc and kind of once it's out of your hand, even if it's a split second, you kick your mini or kick your disc on the way through. As long as the disc is out of your hand at that point, you're safe. You can pretty much do what you want to after that.
True. But don't be surprised if you're playing with somebody who is really
trying to get you
or just rule Nazi kind of thing almost. Mm-hmm. That in real time is going to be really difficult to spot, and you may get called on a foot fault in that situation.
We try and do our best to stay behind them.
So just use a super flat mini.
Yep. That's not a bad idea. I like to, if at all possible, if I'm throwing from a field position, mm-hmm. I like to leave my disc on the ground just because it's a bigger thing to see. It's easier.
I've said this before. The only time I mark my disc is if I'm putting, if I went OB, if I'm establishing a new lie, mm-hmm. or I want to use that disc again. That's the only time. In the middle of fairway, there's no point. I don't care about an extra foot closer. It's mentally easier to hit that bigger target, even if the target is the same size. But mentally, it's easier to hit that bigger disc, so I don't mark discs.
I'm with you on that.
Gotcha. Okay, so something I want to talk about, guys. Me and Anthony are headed down to Tyler, Texas.
Try again. You and
me and Danny are heading down to Tyler, Texas for the Piney Woods Open. And we're going to try something. I think it's going to be a good time. There's a Torchy Taco right mm-hmm. 10 minutes from the course.
Yes.
We're going to head out there and we're going to do our first Disc Golf Answer Man taco meetup. And I'm going to have a few of these taco discs that our graphics guy put together.
Those are awesome.
I know. They turned out really cool. And I'm going to try to see if I can make these available on sale on the website if you want to get your hands on some of these. But it's going to be fun. May not be a lot of people out there, but we're going to be at Torchy's Taco anyway. So we figure might as well meet up with some of you. So if you're in the Tyler, Texas area, it's going to be Friday night at, I think Friday. I put 6:30, 7-ish, something like that.
Now, when does the tournament start?
I think it's Friday, Saturday, Sunday.
Friday, Saturday, Sunday. Okay. I did Friday because Thursday is the kind of the player welcome check-in.
Yep.
Saturday is a player party, and then, of course, Sunday we're going to be gone. So Friday night is the night.
And not to mention
it.
If you are in the area and you're on the fence about playing that tournament, if there's still spots available. I thought we determined today that there was, but go play that event. Dogwood is one of the best courses, challenging-wise, that I've ever played. And it is absolutely worth going down and playing Piney Woods.
Yes, agreed. It's a beast. If I was able to make it down this year, I would love to.
Me too.
I will say, and this is something that Bobby and I have talked about briefly. But as we, you know, as we get into the next year and we're out on the road sometimes, or people are coming to Emporia, this is something that we'd like to do more often.
Yes,
because we want to be able to connect with you guys. When we're out and about, or when you're coming to where we live. And so I would say GBO time, it's going to be an extremely busy time. Mm-hmm. But you can look forward to some plan of a taco meetup here in Emporia. Because we want to hang out with you guys.
Are we doing an Elmar Mall taco meetup?
I mean, we have to. That's the best tacos in town. Yeah. Well, I guess unless you count Nun Tacos. But
well, you can't really you go get to, Nun Tacos.
Exactly.
You know, why don't they do, maybe it's just a Keep It Special or
exactly.
something.
Yeah. Plus, if we go on Tuesday, dollar tacos for everybody. You're welcome.
Right. So we're going to, as traveling happens and we can make it happen, we're going to find a taco place and do a taco meetup so we can taco to you guys.
Let's taco about it.
Let's taco about it. Let's taco about some disc golf questions.
Okay.
This one is from Houston Wolf. Hey, guys, I just found out about your podcast and pretty much listen to it every day on the drive to work now, and I love all the different areas of the game you discuss. I saw quite a while back you guys talked about Hyper Flip versus Anheuser. I'm sorry, you're talking about Hyzer Flip.
Yes.
For distance, and you guys said you prefer Hyzer Flip. I prefer that also. And I feel like my best part of the game is throwing far around 450 to 550 max.
Wow, that's a wide range of max.
Yeah, it is. But recently I've seen some pros crush it. Was farther with the Anheuser Flex. Are they just freaks? Ha.
I mean, yeah.
I don't see too many people. Like, distance contest, most of the time I see Hyzer flips for distance, I feel like. The only time you don't is, like, in the desert.
Even then,
it's, like, super understable distance. They're throwing super high with Hyzer and letting it flip mm-hmm. and ride.
Yes.
I just feel like, personally, I get more flight out of the disc with a Hyzer. If you think about the angle, how it comes out and then flips and rides and comes back, as opposed to just forcing something over. Granted, I don't have the arm power that I used to have for that type of a shot, so a Hyzer flip just makes a lot more sense to me.
Yeah, I agree with that. There's some people who Anheuser is their natural release, think mm-hmm. AJ Risley.
A lot of people, start the game that way, start out playing that way with forcing everything over, probably, one, because they got the wrong discs in their hand in the beginning and trying to make them fly farther, they connect more distance with flipping the disc over more and getting more of that Anheuser release as opposed to starting out with more of a neutral flying disc that they should be throwing.
Yep.
And getting more accurate shots out of them.
Yeah. So in short, they're kind of freaks because it does take a lot more speed to make an overstable disc fly on that Anheuser and flex out than it does a Heiser flip. But yeah, I mean, it's just whichever one fits your body better. Most people, it fits their body better throwing on a Heiser.
Next one comes from Felix.
The cat?
Vega.
Oh, I know Felix.
Hello again, DGAM fam. This is Felix from Atlanta, Georgia. Co-founder of Race Run Productions. Had a question about underrated discs. So I bag a couple of Trilogy discs that maybe aren't as popular. The Bolt in Opto Plastic and the Warrant in Lucid Plastic. Both of which has saved me so many strokes that I'm really surprised when I don't see them in other people's bags. So my question to you guys is, if you had to pick, or if you think off the top of your head, what are some of the more underrated discs that you think disc golfers should be trying that for some reason just aren't flying off the shelves? Like, I know I can get my Bolt about as far as I can any other disc, and my Warrant does about anything I need it to do on approaches or off the tee. So what's something that could really make a difference in a disc golfer's bag if they just gave it a chance, but maybe just isn't getting the love at the moment? Thanks, guys.
What do you guys think?
I think I know what you're
going to say. He was getting ready to turn, too. Could you tell the look?
Yeah, he was turning. He was turning left.
I just feel like he's going to have a better answer than me, so I'm going to defer. I'm going to tell my answer after.
I think I know what your answer is going to be, but I'm going to say the Renegade.
Oh, yeah, I know what everybody's... Oh, no, I don't.
Look at me.
Go ahead.
I'm going to say the Renegade.
Yep.
Renegade is fantastic, and I don't necessarily think it falls in this category because it's one of the more popular discontinued or retired molds that we've done. For me, I actually recently just put a brand new one back in the bag for a roller, and it's been amazing. I absolutely love rolling the Renegade, and for lower arm speeds, it's a great little Heiser flip distance driver. All in all, anybody can bag a Renegade, and I think it's a fantastic
disc. I love the Renegade.
Yeah, it's super good. Yeah. There's two that I used that I think more people should try and spend some time with, and one of those is the Escape.
That was the one I was expecting.
Yeah, that's
you to
a good
say.
One. It's just, man, unless you're really, really putting it out there a long way, right? Like 450 plus always, and you can't dial that back. Mm-hmm. I feel like the Escape could find a spot in your bag. It's not for everybody, but it could be useful for a lot of people in that range. I like it for just little slow Heiser flips, or if I hit it kind of hard, something that'll ride to the right the entire way. Super cool. And I throw it a lot farther than I think I'm going to a lot of times. Yeah. So if I have a big Anheuser that I need to trust not to go back to the left, a lot of times I'll pull Escape over like a Trespass or even a Raider or something like that. Because I don't feel like I have to throw it as hard. The other one I like a lot is the Fuse from Latitude 64.
The Fuse got a lot of traction the past few months, I think, on just some of the touring players bagging it again and talking about it. And, of course, it being Thomas's favorite disc.
Yes. He throws it so well, too.
He does.
It's crazy.
He throws everything well, though.
Yes, he's very smooth. His form is, like, too good to test discs on.
Yeah. Did you see the tournament he won this weekend, too?
Yeah.
He killed it.
Crushed it, man.
My goodness.
So, anyway, those are the two, I think, that I more people should try out.
I would agree with, well, obviously, all three so far.
Yeah. I mean, I think the Warden is popularly or is properly rated. I don't think it's over or underrated. Too. People are just like, hey, this is good.
Yeah.
And I agree.
And then Emax up here.
Well, yeah, it's the best discovery. Yeah, somebody commented that on one of the Instagram posts.
I asked if it was just Eric.
Yeah, is this Eric on
did
a different account?
Did you see his response, though?
Not yet.
What a great response. I'll let you go.
Okay, I'll get to it. I'll get to it.
All right, next one comes from Cody.
I kind of had two questions a day for you.
Let's try it again.
Okay.
Hey, guys.
Nope.
This is...
Wrong button. Here we go.
Hey, Disc Golf Answer Man. I kind of had two questions a day for you. I was thinking about this. Greg Barsby was sponsored on Westside however many years ago, and I was wondering if you guys can remember anything from his bag. Like, what did he throw when he was on Team Westside?
I remember.
And then kind of a follow-up similar question. What would you guys say is most comparable to the Eagle? For any Trilogy brand, I really like that 7-speed, overstable, kind of accepts the forehand really well type of disc. Thanks, guys, for all you do.
Thanks, Cody.
Yeah,
I remember him throwing.
I remember Barsby being sponsored by Westside. I remember it was in 2012, because I remember it was 11 and 12 or 12 and 13, one of those two. Right, I just remember it being the year, like, right before we partnered with Latitude, and then that first year of us all throwing, he was still throwing Westside at that point. I remember that. And I remember there were some Barsby Boatmans.
I remember those.
That were floating around, and I know he threw the Boatman and the Giant, and I know he threw both of those discs very well. So those are the two that off the top of my head, I can remember. I know, and when he was sponsored by Westside, it was a whole different thing. It wasn't like being on, it's not like being on Westside now, where if you are on Team Westside now, you have the option to throw some Latitude discs, some Dynamic discs. Mm-hmm. Back then, it was just Westside, and then I believe he could have had a mixed bag at that point, because right. I think he still had like some, maybe his putter was still like an AVR or something like that. But
yeah,
I do remember he was throwing a Boatman and a Giant. I do remember that, because I gave him a pretty sick Giant.
Yeah. Those, before we had Enforcers and everything,
the Giant, those dude, Giants, I go home and ballers. I've got a bin with probably 20, 30, 40 Giants in it from back then. And I feel them. I'm like, man, I should maybe revisit this disc.
I should totally throw this. It is amazing.
Like those matte white Giants were,
oh my goodness,
just amazing flying discs.
Too good. Too good.
So good. What was the second part of his question? He had a second part. I don't recall it right now. Flies an eagle.
Yeah.
I threw the Eagle when it first released in Champion Plastic, like, many, many years ago. I don't know. I honestly don't know, because I don't really recall how it flew. The T-Bird, I can tell you, but is an Eagle just a more stable version of the T-Bird? Slower, maybe?
Maybe like a tick slow. They're the same rim width.
So similar to like a Boatman, like what we just talked about? Or
I think slower than a Boatman, for sure. It's in that 7-8 speed range. Boatman's like an 11 or something like that. So maybe it's not the same speed, but maybe something like a Culverin might be a good one. I don't know. Something like, or even like a Biofelon, something that's going to be nice and stable, but not just super beef.
Flight-wise, don't paying attention to the numbers or speed, how fast it is or anything like that, or the rim size, but just pure flight, I would agree with that.
Yeah, for sure.
For sure.
I thought when you were starting that one, you accidentally clicked on the wrong one and you went back, and I thought you were going to do the, hey, cool daddy, slick. Oh, yeah. I thought it was that one.
I should have. This one's from Mr. Miranda. He's going to read us your rights.
Yeah, Mr. Miranda writes.
I'm 5'7". I have a 72-inch wingspan.
Oh, whoa.
How do I throw?
5'7 and a 6-foot wingspan.
Good for him.
Lucky duck.
How do I throw using my wingspan as an advantage on the course rather than just being able to grab things off of tall shelves as a short person? Thanks, and keep it real. I'm going to keep it
his
real.
His knuckles drag the ground when
with
he walks.
With the wingspan like that, you can just pick the disc up and fly it over to the basket.
Uh-huh.
Yeah, that's good.
Respect.
No. What's the deal? How can we help this gentleman out?
Man, that's a big wingspan. I can't really get over that. Like,
yeah, I mean, what do they say? Most people are like a square where you are as tall as your wingspan is wide.
Yeah.
His wingspan is 5 inches
wider than he is tall. So he's a rectangle.
He is tall. Yeah. Yeah.
He's an octagon.
Math checks out. Anyway,
I've been studying math.
That would be algebra checks out, right?
No.
No. What?
Biology. Math. It's biology, all right?
No.
Oh,
which
yes.
Math deals with shape. Geometry.
Oh, biochemistry.
Geometry.
Oh, trigonometry. Physics.
Oh.
Yeah. Basic math.
Geometry.
That's what I was in.
Yeah, geometry is right.
Basic math.
So. Math 101. Mm-hmm. Okay, so let's
arithmetic.
Get to the
1 plus 1 is 2.
That's right.
Minus Where are we
one,
at?
Minus 1 has 3 quick maths. Okay. Roll it back. How do you leverage quick longer math. Limbs? Okay, so I would think that you would try and find your longest possible lines to throw on, right? So one way that you would, like, the opposite of utilizing longer limbs is not using a full reach back. Yeah. So think about, like, who's someone who's really lanky? Will Schustrick. Will is tall and has long limbs, and his reach back is crazy far. Like, he gets a full shoulder extension, really uses his long limbs to throw the disc farther. That's one thing that I would use if I were you, because you naturally have that little bit of extra action on your, you know, your built-in levers to try that. So making sure that you do that is going to be key number one for me. Any thoughts on that?
That's a big wingspan.
Yeah, you're lucky.
You're stuck on all I can too. Get off that. That's awesome.
It's an octagon.
Wish I could do that. It is an octagon.
Math checks out.
Stop. All right, next one is from Jonathan.
Hey, guys. This is Jonathan from South Carolina. I literally just took up disc golf in the last few weeks. I have spent most of my time just doing field work and working on my form based on videos and advice from local players. My question to you is, how would you tell a brand new person to start in terms of practice routine? Should I be spending more time in the field, working on my form, getting to where I can throw straight before playing a lot of rounds? A combination of both. Right now I'm doing mostly field work and, you know, playing some holes. I haven't played a full round yet, but I've played some holes. Wow. And practiced putting. I'm just curious, you know, what your advice would be to someone that's so new to the sport. Thanks. I really appreciate you guys. Some of your podcasts and YouTube videos have really helped me out to understand what the heck is going on. Keep up the great work. Peace.
Hasn't played a full round yet?
Welcome to Disc Golf Answer, wow, man. We're happy to have you, man.
That's crazy, though, to think of. Hasn't played a full round. But he's gone out and done a lot of practicing, which is awesome to see.
Good for you.
Yeah. I would, you know, in the beginning, I've always suggested to people, go out and play rounds and see. After you play a few rounds, that's when you'll know where you're kind of suffering, like, or struggling. Mm-hmm. Like, for instance, you shoot pretty hot one day, and then the next day you're struggling off the tee or through the putts. And just kind of figure out where your game needs the most work before moving forward. But I always say always practice on your putt, because the putt is the easiest thing in the smallest space you need to work on.
Yep.
You don't need a big open field for that. You just need one basket. That's really all you need. And focusing on that. And if I would have done that in the beginning, I think I could have been a lot better as far as that goes. And I mean, yeah. So you know what I'm trying to say?
Like, I do.
Putting.
It's the easiest thing to practice.
It's the easiest thing to practice, but it's also the most important thing in our game. You know, if you're hitting your putts, you're winning events for the most part.
Right.
I mean, the drives will come natural, kind of. But I would absolutely spend as much time around that basket as you possibly can.
Yeah. Yeah, that's true. And I think there really is something to what you said. Is awesome on you for continuing to practice mm-hmm. a lot. But, man, go out and play. Like, the most, at least to me, the most fun part of disc golf is, like, playing an actual round, you know, trying to keep score, trying to throw good shots. I love throwing in a field because it's cool. You get to watch the disc fly, and it looks awesome. That's really cool. But, like, doing it to a result is what most people like the most. So I would say just get out there and start throwing and enjoying yourself.
Yeah.
And don't worry about what your score is to start. Like, you can keep score if you want to.
I wouldn't even do that.
But, yeah, just go enjoy yourself. Like, throw a shot where you're headed toward a basket, and eventually the disc gets in the basket, and then you move on to the next. That's, for me, the most fun part of it.
Yeah. I don't really keep score now. I don't think I ever really did going out and practicing. Every now and then I will if we're playing for something, but for the most part, it's just, at this point, just going out and enjoying a round of disc golf.
Right. Well, and I mean, think about this too. When you play tournaments, you win every time because you don't keep score. Get to the end and you're just like, man, what did you shoot? I won better.
I feel like I shot better than that.
Yeah, I was probably better than that.
So the other day, or I think it was yesterday. It was yesterday because that's Tuesday. Eric walks in.
I did.
And says, hey, Bobby, check this out. And I saw this, and I about flipped my lid. I thought it was awesome. A gentleman named Theo created this for
Theo.
Us. And didn't even know he was making it, but it's a metal.
Metal.
Like metal Sweet. Sheet. Like sheet metal, I guess. And he fabricated this together.
Possibly.
And it is awesome. Let me go full screen. Let me go full screen for you. Scoot it over more toward the middle, and then, boom! Now people can see. Now this is for the YouTube people. So if you're
much better,
if you're listening, you'll have to. I'll post a picture on the Facebook Disc Golf Answerman Facebook group. so you guys can check it out. But yes, that is such a cool thing. We're going to try to figure out where we're going to put it. We're going to obviously hang it here in the office to show it off. So thank you, Theo.
Thanks, Theo, for from creating Denver.
That. And that is just amazing.
It's pretty sweet.
So cool. Very cool.
Crafty.
Stuff.
Pretty nice.
See, it's crafty.
Not that kind of crafty.
Oh, okay. All right. So back to the split screen. There we go. All right, so back to the questions. This one from Todd Steele. Hey, fellas, love what you do. Keep up the good work. My questions relate to indoor courses. I live in the panhandle of North Idaho, and disc golf becomes pretty unplayable in the winter. What do you guys think of them?
Think of what? The winter?
That's what he says. Indoor courses.
Oh.
Oh.
I've never played an indoor course.
Has Eric ever designed an indoor course?
I'm interested, though.
What is generally the method of building one? I assume they've privatized as it would be in a building as opposed to a public park like most courses. Am I right in this assumption? And if so, and what is the general business model? Is there, I'm going to sound totally ignorant, but is there even an indoor course anywhere?
Bobby, you're not familiar with the Indoor Disc Golf Association?
The IDGA?
No.
God.
Where have you been, dude? Oh my goodness.
Not Do you just zone out when we talk?
Yes.
God, that's what we spent all morning talking about.
Oh my gosh. Unbelievable.
Yeah.
It doesn't exist.
Yeah, that's not a thing.
I don't know. I've never heard of it. The only thing I've done indoors is putted and mini golf. I've played a couple mini courses that were inside.
Yes.
Like Bourbon Cowboy at the Glass Blown Open every year.
Nice.
Yeah, I mean, that's the only thing is you're going to get, like, short courses that aren't much of anything other than for putting.
Mm-hmm.
So
unless you've got, if you've got, let me tell you, if you've got space.
The indoor facility.
For an indoor disc golf course.
Where would you even do that?
Hit me up. I would be interested.
It'd have to be like a huge airplane hangar or something.
Yeah, or bigger.
Or a football stadium. Hey, we should do that.
Hey, wait. There, that I guess I forgot about that. I have thrown indoors, technically, in Dallas.
Yes.
The only one, right?
Yeah.
That was indoor.
So, but, I mean, obviously, there isn't anything permanent.
No, like but, that. However, I do see a lot of, I know the Europeans do this a lot throughout the winter. I know Latitude 64 will rent out an indoor, I don't know if it's a soccer arena or what it is, but they go and that's where they test discs when they first get them. They'll throw some discs inside, but.
But even then, they can't really like crush them, right?
You can't. You can always hit the wall, and it's not going to be like you don't have. It's not the same. You know, when we go and throw inside somewhere, it's not the same as having the feel of the openness outside with wind
and the elements.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. Exactly.
I'm interested,
though.
Liquid Sausages says, all right, here's the deal.
Okay.
Let's hear it, Liquid.
I've never been to Glass Blown Open. Why do you even listen to this?
Liquid Sausages.
Yeah, I know. Not cool of me. When does the registration open up? When can I sign up for the smaller XC tiers? Should I camp, Airbnb, hotel, or just sleep on a park bench?
Everything.
Give me the expert Emporia lowdown on the GBO.
One of each. But I would suggest renting a hotel now if you're going to do that.
You're going to want to be indoors.
Also, thanks for giving me the confidence I needed to get my first tourney win. He floored the gourd and flying them fuses.
Oh, yeah. So front to gourd.
Guard and fuse. So, yeah, awesome. GBO, in fact, we were just talking about this morning at our little general employee meeting. You can go to glassblownopen.com and go to the players.
Like registration time.
No
yeah,
joke.
That's crazy. Players flying. And then registration information drop-down menu, and you can see the dates. We start November 5th with international students, and then every week after that.
Try again?
Did I say students?
You did.
Yep, transfer students.
We've transferred from Glass Blown Open. It's only collegiate.
And they just come out. Anyway.
You have the issue of that your brain is so far past where your words are.
But where do students even fall into that?
I don't know.
I was just thinking international.
Farhan, bro.
Farhan, apparently.
Got to throw that Farhan.
Gosh. Anyway, international players. And then weeks after that, we will do different divisions. So make sure you go and check out those dates.
Yep.
And you're familiar, so you're ready to go. Because they will fill up fast. As far as the XC tiers, I believe those will open up. Probably once all the other registration is done.
Around that time.
Again, more information at glassblownopen.com. We're building another GBO mobile app that will be ready to go. My launch date, I have that, is for November 1st. So,
As far as the C tiers go, I wouldn't recommend signing up for all of them. Like, you could.
You will die.
But that is
A lot of disc golf.
A whole lot of disc golf. Let I mean, you could do play. It. I would love to see it. I would love to see somebody try it.
Somebody in the chat here hit us with some knowledge that I think we would probably want to talk about.
Ooh, is it an indoor course?
Yeah, at the prison that they do in Joliet.
That oh, yeah, that's that who. We were the talking putting, about.
And incarcerated.
But that's I mean, I don't know. I've never been there.
I don't know
it's
much
a putting,
about it.
It's a putting league.
Right, that's what
is.
I'm saying.
It's not like full-on throws.
Right.
Oh, I thought it was throws.
It's a putting league. Maybe it is. No, you're right. There is one that they do as a putting league, and I think that they also do one that has throws, like in the yard and through some of the cells, possibly.
Sure, I don't know.
But that's not like a that's like a.
It's not like a permanent course. Yeah. It's a temporary.
Yeah, but like how
thing.
Far is the throw, Anthony?
It's like the stadium ones.
It's
like
a stadium.
Kind of like short holes.
So,
yeah.
I mean, I get that, but it's not like playing an open. It's not like you've got a biodome over a huge.
Ooh,
park.
I'm interested. Pauly Shore gonna
is
be there?
Yeah. I was gonna say is Pauly Shore present
and Stephen Baldwin.
Yeah, one. Of
yeah,
those
I think
Baldwins.
He was in there. A biodome over a huge park, and you can just throw indoors. Is what
I'm interested. We're raising money to put a dome over Emporia.
Yes, so. The entirety of Emporia. All right,
so it looks like Todd sent in a question on SpeakPipe as well. All
right, what's up?
This is Todd from Idaho. Just had a quick question for you about practicing. Like I said, I live up in North Idaho. I haven't been playing for very long, and my form is just kind of getting to a spot where I like it. And as the months get colder and we get closer to our snowy season, I won't be able to play or practice as much. Just wanted to know if you guys had any tips on anything I could do indoors. I have a basket that I put in my garage, so I'll be able to practice putting, but I don't know what I can really do about driving.
He's back on this indoor thing.
I thought about maybe putting a mattress up against the wall or something, but then I can't really see where the disc will go after I throw it, so I don't know if I'll be using good form or not, and if I'll come back into the spring with horrible form, thinking I've been doing good. So thanks for your answer. Thanks for everything you guys do. Peace.
Yeah, basically you're just gonna be terrible when you get back, and so
just get out and play.
Yeah, no. I mean, there really that's just like we kind of talked about. There's really no indoor courses. If you could find a soccer indoor soccer field or some kind of indoor football field, that'd be one thing. But I would assume it's not going to be available to you whenever all the time. So you're just going to have to get yourself a net or something like that and throw inside, or a sheet and throw inside and just kind of
or brave the elements.
And I'm assuming you can do some form work without knowing where the disc is going to go. I mean, you can work on your form, right? You're just not going to like
his
learn the disc.
His
and
concern
stuff.
Was to be repetitively working on
bad form.
Incorrect form,
yeah, right.
And transfer over to the spring, which I could see, but set up a camera. I mean, and then study what you're doing.
Yeah, set up again, or maybe post it on the Facebook group. Mm-hmm. People can help you out and coach you there. So I know it stinks. I wish we had a better answer, but, move to Florida.
Yeah, well, and work on your flexibility in the winter. That's
simple
a
solution.
move
to Florida.
That's true, Todd. Well, work on your flexibility in that season, because mm-hmm. flexibility is one of the most important things I think that's overlooked a lot in disc golf.
And your putt. Work on your putt.
Work on eating tacos.
And your putt.
Next one comes from Matthew.
What's up, Bobby Cool, Daddy Slick Breeze? Eric, I sold my soul for the truth, McCabe. And Robert, I'm naming my first child Warden, McCall. I played in a tournament this past weekend, shot average, pretty proud of it. A couple days before the tournament, though, I left my putters at work because I have a practice basket at work. And I played around without my normal putters. I putt with Judge.
Do you even care, Matthew?
Wow. I would never leave my putters at work.
Ever.
I actually do that a lot.
I don't take my putters to work.
The work is here. So.
Well, we have about 1,000 putters here. Yeah. So.
Most of them are mine.
Yes.
When you see them on the go ahead. Okay.
Keystone on me, so I just putted with that. I actually putted really well in my casual round before the tournament. And in the tournament, the day before the tournament, I was putting with my judges. Everything felt fine. The judges felt a little bit weird, but I was like, whatever. I was putting with them. And then in the second round, I lost my putt. The judge felt foreign in my hand. I was missing easy putts, missed a couple birdie opportunities, and if I would have hit those, I would have placed and got a few discs or whatever. So I'm just doubting the judges now. I was wondering if
it is not the judge, my friend. It is not.
Will
the
you
judge.
Let him finish, oh, I'm sorry. Please?
If any of you have ever been through that, and if you think maybe because I do like throwing the Keystone, I like putting with the Keystone. Actually, I push putt. And, I just want to know if you guys have any experience with that. That's all I got. Love the show. Love you. Bye.
Bye. Okay, now go ahead,
Bobby. I guess you won't be leaving your putters at work anymore, will you?
Yeah. Now go ahead with what you were saying before.
It's not the judge's fault. That's all.
That's fair.
Okay. That's my advice. I have.
You're absolutely speaking to the wrong person about this because I haven't changed putters in a very long time. But someone sitting next to me has changed putters.
Bobby?
Well, no, he's put over. No, you.
Oh,
not like recent, not like super recently, right. But a few times.
Of the three of us, you like change every putters year? More often.
Talk about what goes into that for you.
Putting them to the side and grabbing something new. And
you see, I go to the shelves.
You see, I go to the shelves and I'm like,
which one of these? No.
No. Yeah, absolutely. I have kind of that moving over that has been kind of a struggle of mine, trying to find a putter that has worked for me. And at the end of the day, it's all between the ears. Honestly, yes. It's about 90% mental, I would say. I mean, honestly, you know, there's only really 10% that's really needed skill wise on the putting green.
Mm-hmm.
You know, confidence obviously goes in there as well, but that's kind of mixed in with anyway. I have switched a lot of putters. I started out when we first started making discs. I think the Mercy was the first disc putter that I went to. A bunch of us did, actually. A bunch of us went to the Mercy. And then we released the Judge. I started putting with the Judge, and I really liked it and went back to the Mercy. And then, you know, I was kind of Judge and Mercy back and forth for quite some time. Yeah. And with the Judge, I absolutely loved the Judge, but I noticed when I was missing putts, it would be short left. So they kind of fade out before it got to the basket. And the Mercy, and now I put with the Warden, seems to hold that straight line just a little bit longer and stays in the air a little bit longer, meaning I can be a little bit more relaxed on my putt and not have to be as aggressive with my putting. And I really enjoyed that. And honestly, it's all about – it's kind of like you said. I feel what you're saying. How going back to it felt foreign in the hand and you were missing short putts. It's absolutely all mental, as Bobby kind of alluded to in a rather rude way.
Yeah, what the heck, Bobby?
But,
I'm never rude.
But he was just keeping it real. I have no regrets. So we know that's what he does. But yeah.
No regrets, no restraint.
No regrets. But hey, if you're feeling the Keystone and it feels great and it's flying great and it's putting great, I say go for it.
Yes, I'm going to agree with that. So I agree.
I'm going to disagree. Oh, I'm sorry.
You shouldn't. That was correct.
I'll wait for him. He can he can disagree and he can explain why. You
know? I'm going to agree to disagree.
Yeah.
I'm going to disagree to disagree.
Yes. Wait, so do we agree? Or, I know. I think there's, like you said, punting probably is largely mental.
Mm-hmm.
You know, if you aren't committed to the putt, if you're not following through and like allowing your body to follow through, you're just not going to make putts. That's all there is to it. But there is something to, if your putter is just feeling terrible in your hand, and you don't stand a chance. Yeah, this is the same as I feel about if a disc doesn't feel good to me the first time I try it out. You know, like if the shape is weird, or maybe the underside of the rim feels weird to me or whatever, I'm never going to throw that disc because I need to have confidence in whatever disc I have in my hand. True. If I don't have it, there's no reason to force that. So like maybe I like the flight of the Judge. But I don't like how it feels. I'm never going to putt with that disc. I'm only going to putt with something that feels good to me.
Mm-hmm.
For me, that's been the Warden for a long time, but let's say they started feeling really weird or something changed where I was just supremely not confident.
Like you lost a finger or something.
Or something like that. I mean, I don't know.
Your grip changes.
Yeah. I mean, catastrophes aside, but if something else, just maybe we come out with a new putter, and something, it just feels really good. I'll try it out, no problem. But otherwise, I wouldn't be hasty to make a change unless it just feels so bad you just know you're not going to make him anymore.
Yep.
At that point, it is time.
There's
to
a sentiment I've heard that I think if you're putting between 25 feet and in, you can basically make any putter work.
Yeah.
Within reason.
Within reason, but you can basically make any putter work, but it comes down to what you're most comfortable with.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
What feels good in that.
Yeah.
I mean, you're going to have some difference between like a slammer and a deputy. From,
right,
from
there's
25.
Gonna be a difference, but my point is
everybody who plays disc golf could, yeah,
you could
reasonably
make
it
right.
Work.
Right, you're going to throw them differently,
right?
But you're not going to. You could make it work within that 25 to 0 feet.
I agree.
Zero feet. This is from the Houston PDX.
Sweet.
When watching the first round coverage of the 2019 European Open, something happened on the first hole that got me thinking.
Ooh.
Eagle and Macbeth parked the hole, resulting in drop-in birdies. Simon's shot settled about 45 feet from the basket, and he stepped up and nailed the putt for birdie. All three got the two. On
Sweet.
The first hole, would you rather pure the line and get the drop-in birdie, or build that putting confidence by cashing a circle two putt? Birdies are birdies, but what helps the mental game more? That's an interesting perspective.
Yeah. I know the answer for me, but you go ahead.
I would say jamming the 40-foot putt is probably better mentally, but I would much rather have the drop in.
I'm on that same train.
Would it almost depend on what round it is? What if it's the first round? But what if it's the third round and you're battling to get back, battling for position? You'd almost feel more comfortable having that drop-in birdie, right?
I would No. I think in that situation, I'd feel more confident jamming my putt moving forward, knowing that
your putt's on.
My putt's on.
Let's go.
Yeah,
that's true.
Right. But that being said, I've played many tournaments, hundreds of tournaments, thousands of rounds. I don't know how many times I've jammed a big putt on the first hole and went on to have a horrible round.
Mm. Yeah.
Today's
the day.
I also don't know how many times, more often than not, have I missed a putt on the first hole or not birdied a relatively easy first hole and went on to kill it and play some of the best golf I've ever played in my life. So I don't know what the difference is there, but sometimes I'm okay not birdieing the first hole.
Mm-hmm. I would say if given the option, almost any round, I would say parking the first hole, just because, I mean, most people are reasonably okay putters. Some are better than others, of course. But if your driving is on, like one of the things that we've learned from watching U-Disc statistics over the last few years is that most of the people who are at the top of the MPO field are the people who are the best drivers, mm-hmm. who have the highest circle two in regulation and circle one in regulation statistics. Which means that they're getting opportunities to birdie. I think I would rather park that first hole for the reason of one, that's not stressful to me anymore. My stress is completely gone until we go to the next hole. Whereas if I leave it 40 short, maybe I'm thinking I probably should have thrown a better shot. You still convert, but if my driving is on, I feel like everything else is going to be good. So that's what it would be for me.
Gotcha. All righty. What happened?
Nothing.
My level of play, I would want to park it, just because for me, that would give me the confidence to say, okay, I would feel like my game is more on.
Yeah.
Whereas a 45-foot putt would be like
super bonus.
I would feel more bonus.
That's what Johnny V's saying in the chat.
Yeah,
right,
that would feel more bonus.
Whereas Johnny V never makes 45
foot. He said, I don't get too upset if I missed every 40-footer during a round.
That's true.
So I don't even feel like hitting a 40-footer would make me think my putting was on. That's a fair point.
Yeah, that's kind of what I was getting at.
I could see that side of things, but to me, hitting that 40-foot putt, knowing I'm going for that 40-foot putt, that tells me, hey, my putt's on point today.
Right.
Moving forward.
Doesn't matter where I throw it.
Doesn't matter where I'm at off the tee.
Right.
I'm going to jam session all day long.
The difference is a 45-foot putt isn't as much of a bonus for you as it would be for me and Johnny V.
I haven't ever seen Eric make very many 45-footers.
It's true.
What was that? Except for every time we go play.
This one is from Todd Steele again. Boy, he's really cashing in on his his money's worth this.
His free
episode.
Money.
Second question is, in a week, he's very sorry for that. Actually, it's your third question, Todd. I've been playing a couple months, and in my area, we have a course with very narrow fairways.
And it's inside.
It's
sick.
If it hyzes one way or the other, you're in the trees. What's the straightest flying disc you know of for a newer player who throws about 200 feet?
Ooh. straight disc for a 200-foot throw is probably going to be in, like, your understable mid-range section. So, like...
Fuse?
A fuse would be good. A warrant might be good. If you're throwing those and maybe they're too much moving to the right for you, I doubt they would be, but let's just assume. You might check out the original Truth. Mm-hmm. That might be a little bit straighter, as well as like a Claymore from a Latitude 64. Those are really, really straight at slower speeds.
I would almost suggest a putter as well.
Yeah, I like that.
Putter off the tee on those type of shots.
And if you're going to go that route, probably a Deputy would be a really good one to choose for a straight shot.
Keystone.
At 200 feet, if you can only throw 200 feet.
Keystone.
Okay. Yeah. Yeah, Keystone would be a good one too.
Because the Deputy, once it's like my beat-in Deputies will start turning to the right for me.
Yeah, but you can also throw farther than 200.
400? Yeah, yeah.
You could throw
farther than 200.
Oh, 200. Yeah. Oh, okay.
200 and
Far hand, right. All right, this last question comes from Brandon. YouTube watchers, get your questions in so we can ask them on the after show show, and then we'll talk about our picks from the last. We're going to see how Eric McKay did on his picks.
Probably awesome.
He ain't worried. This one's from Brandon.
You don't remember who you picked, did you?
Good morning, DGAM crew. Bobby, Robert, and hopefully Eric.
What's up?
This is Brandon from Atchison, Kansas.
Nice.
I'm staying here at the start of Darcy Park in the greater Boston area, which is a little bittersweet this morning.
Boston.
I flew up to New York for a work conference this week.
And now he's in Boston.
And I had a goal of playing 5 18-hole disc golf courses in one day in 5 different states.
You crazy.
I started out in New Jersey at Camp Crenshaw or Camp Graw Reservations, and then went to New York at Leonard Park and Veterans Memorial Park in Connecticut, then on to Willow Valley in Rhode Island, and finally got to Darcy Park at the end of the evening and only able to play 3 holes with the light.
Oh.
Unfortunately and fortunately, the courses up here in New England are wooded and hilly. The first course I played was on a ski slope where I had 950 feet of elevation gain over 18 holes. But had a blast playing it. And then thankfully, my wife actually ran 2 of the courses with me in New York and Connecticut, and then was my running scorekeeper in Rhode Island. So we had a great time.
Nice.
All that said, what are your guys' favorite regions of the country to play in? Being from Kansas, I feel like we're spoiled and we get a large variety of disc golf. I like playing in the Rocky Mountains in Colorado, as well as going down to Texas.
Time.
Wow, ran right out of time.
Yep.
So what's your favorite region?
My goodness.
It's a tough one.
It's super tough. I do love the Northeast, but Pacific Northwest is amazing. There's just beautiful terrain up there and just awesome courses. But I'm going to say I grew up in the Midwest. I'm going to say Midwest courses. Like Iowa. I always talk about Iowa, how I love
Des Moines,
Iowa courses.
Quad Cities.
Just big, beautiful rolling hills, park-style golf. It's kind of like a combination of bigger championship level and tight woods, but more sporadic trees. You know, just it's beautiful. Yeah. I absolutely love the entire state of Iowa as far as disc golf goes.
Yep. I started playing in Texas. I love Texas disc golf. It's not the most variety across the board. Although, you know, if you think of Roy G. Guerrero in Austin, that's one of my favorites that I've ever played. But if I had to pick any area in the world, I'm taking Finland.
Yeah, Finland was fun.
That's not,
there's some good
courses, not in the U.S., so disregard that. But that was, I mean, even their courses that didn't seem like tournament courses were incredible. It's just beautiful.
The courses that we went to and the
we played the little
The one at that water tower. That place was amazing.
Yes. Then one on a ski kind of slope.
And it rained the entire time, but it was so much fun.
Super cool. But I will say the other place that I've played just a little bit that I think is awesome is up in the Northeast.
Yep.
Super woods.
Tight woods.
I love wooded golf, man. As long as it's fair enough.
Mm-hmm.
And it's not just poke and hope. I like wooded golf a lot.
Agreed. I really haven't been to a region that I'm just like, wow, this just sucks. You know?
Yeah.
As far as the courses go, like everywhere I've played, I've enjoyed myself.
Yeah.
Enjoyed the courses.
What about you there, Bobby? What portion of the country do you like to play in? Wherever.
Yeah. I don't like, and I'm going to get probably razzed about this, but I don't particularly like courses that have, like, are just pretty dense with trees. I get that it tests your skill out, and I get that it improves your skills or whatnot, but I've played some pretty wooded courses, and it to me it gets frustrating when I keep hitting trees. And I'm sure people will say, well, just get better, play better. Well, I don't play better, so I don't – I don't.
Well, I tried that already.
Yeah, I get frustrated. So, now I do like – I'm not saying completely open courses.
You like park-style courses.
I like park-style courses, yes.
That's what you grew up playing. That's what you learned to play on. Right. So it makes sense.
So, I mean, I like having to create lines, and I like having to do – you know, my fairway shots have to be maybe a turnover and a fancy shot and things like that. That's great, but when it's like I'm on my fifth shot because I've hit three trees, yep. To me, it's not fun anymore.
Sometimes three trees on one shot.
Yeah.
It hurts.
Doubt. Little plinko.
We're going to tell them about our job changes, or is that an after show?
I thought we talked topic. About that. Oh, we talked about that on the updates. That's right.
Yeah,
my bad.
We did.
I get that.
We can talk about it on the
after show.
All right, guys. So we talked about it a little bit last time because you wouldn't let me tell them.
We most
certain,
certainly did not talk
projects
about it.
That you were gonna
we
do.
Didn't talk about it last time because it hadn't been publicly announced last time.
You're right on that.
Never right test that. My memory. I'm like an elephant.
You look like an elephant. So this is the end of the show. Thank you so much. YouTube guys, hang on there for a little bit. We're going to do the after show for audio listeners. We'll see you tomorrow. Keep sending those questions in. Make sure you subscribe to the YouTube channel. Tell your friends so we can hit the first milestone of 43,000 subscribers. We're going to give away some prizes. We're going to give away some prizes for every 1,000 subscriber milestone we hit all the way till we hit 50,000 subscribers when we're going to give away that portable veteran basket.
Let's go.
So go to dynamicdiscs.com/road to 50K to get a little more details and the terms and conditions. Enter your information in there, and your name will be entered in to win the prizes. Thanks, guys. We'll see you on the next show. 5-star.
Good thing you didn't have the shock mount for that one.
Boom. All right, I'm going to stand up real quick, YouTuber, so hang tight.
Stand up.
I'm going to stand up and stretch.
I'm going to lean back for a second. Sorry, YouTubers, my throat hurts today. Got a little bit of sickness going on. But hey, if you guys have questions that you'd like us to answer, if you drop those in the chat, that would be fantastic. Doc says he heard 51,000 subscribers goal was Robert's hair. If by my hair you mean that I shave my hair at 51,000 subscribers, then you misheard, my friend. It would take way more than 51,000 subscribers to do that.
$51,000.
I would 100% I would 100% shave my head for $51,000. As bald as could be. For $51,000? Yes.
How about $51?
No.
$510.
No. But $5,100, we're getting closer.
$5,100.
What's the cheapest you would do it for?
$5,100? Would you at least go jarhead?
Just nah, man. I don't know. Honestly,
$5,100. That's
a lot of money.
You got projects going on in the house.
Yeah, home projects.
That would help.
We got plenty of financials.
Walter
to
needs
think
a new
about,
bed. So. He needs a new. He needs some more water bottle to chew up.
Walter needs to be happy.
What was
with
going
what
on
got.
Last night? Was he really just playing?
With a bone. He just kept dropping it on the floor. Yeah, he's cool. He's not really clumsy with it.
It was just funny. I was like,
how
okay.
about 51,000 yen? I'm going to pass on that one, Greldick.
Yeah, what is the exchange rate?
I think that's about $40.
No,
okay. I honestly don't know.
Okay. All right, let's get this party started.
Doc said, what if you knew your hair would never grow back as good? I don't know if it would. I'd be scared.
Welcome to the after show.
That was lame.
I look forward to the mixdown on that, though.
Yeah, but
it's
I
been
do,
fun.
I do a mixdown up on
in post. Thing. He makes it.
Yeah, dude. I know. It just seems lame right now.
This
I know,
is
it seems for lame. All of our viewers.
Yes. This is going to sound like whatever, so just hear it as I understand that this sounds crappy. But when we were listening to the episode last night with the mix down into the show, I was like, first of all, that's really cool that you do that. Because we don't know. We just sit here and talk, right?
Yeah.
But I feel like these microphones make us sound really cool and professional.
They do.
I love it. It's the work
and
of the microphone.
It's not
ours.
I put on there. I put a little.
Yeah, a little stuff.
Awesome sauce on there.
Yeah,
a little sauce on.
Yeah, industry secret.
So, all right. So this is the after show where we're a little more relaxed. We're going to talk about a few little things. But first thing we want to talk about is, you may have seen the announcement on Facebook and on our blog, but we have some job shifting going on here at Dynamic Discs, as we are always working on something. One of the things is Brian Shintaku. It's officially Shintaku, right?
Yes.
It's not like officially.
People call him Taco.
That's his name.
That's his name. It's not like we changed his name with his position.
His payroll signature is Shintaku. He is now team manager for Westside Discs in Latitude 64. Eric McCabe has taken on added to his role as team manager for Dynamic Discs.
Correct.
He will still, a lot of people are asking, but is he still going to design
question,
courses?
If I will still be designing courses.
Yeah.
Absolutely. My focus is still heavily through the course design, and I don't plan on slowing down there. But as I think Jeremy had mentioned, I spend a lot of time on the road. I spend a lot of time in hotels or whatnot, and I have a lot of time that I can reach out and make sure everything's going great. And one good thing for me in being in this position is I've been there. Like, I know what each one of these touring guys and gals want and deserve and need, and not saying I can get that all for them, but I know exactly kind of what they feel like they need.
Yeah, at every level of competition.
Yeah.
Yeah, so super excited about that. Now, that puts Robert into a different role, and he is now the, one of two ways, depends on how you look at it. He's either the marketing director or the director of marketing.
Your choice. If you go by what the website says, it's marketing director.
Okay.
But if you go by what I say, it's what the website says. Okay. But sometimes I'll say, if I want to sound fancy, I'll say director of marketing.
Director of marketing. So you're going to hear a lot more, see a lot more of Robert in our media and any other media things that happen, say the live commentary and stuff like that happens out in the disc golf world.
Yeah, and you'll probably see me in more ways than you think. I respond to a lot of comments on our posts and things like that. So a lot of times if you're interacting with Dynamic Discs on Facebook or Instagram or YouTube, sometimes you're interacting with me there.
What about Twitter?
Also on Twitter, yeah. Sorry. I forgot to include that one, but I have been doing that.
Unbelievable.
I know. I'm sorry. It's all just in this one place that we use to manage all that stuff.
Pulse.
I just go through.
Oh, and LinkedIn. If you're on LinkedIn, follow Dynamic Discs.
Please do.
What's the other one that you're doing now?
TikTok.
Oh, you talked about TikTok. Are we going to create one?
We're going to try some stuff on TikTok.
TikTok.
I've been
in the
learning phase.
Same here. Same here.
TikTok. And there's a lot of, I mean, but that's how we used to think about Snapchat, right? God, this weird. Snapchat's the whole thing, you know, so it's kind of weird at first, but I got to watch it, observe it to figure out how we can play it within our strategies here.
To answer a couple questions on the board here, Chris Goodrich says, assistant to the marketing director. No, Chris, just marketing director. And then SDay99 says, so is Bobby the assistant to the director of marketing? No, Bobby is the media director. Bobby and I work not hand in hand. That makes it sound like we walk around holding hands and skipping together.
They do.
To be fair, we kind of do sometimes. But I think our strategies are aligned with one another. Right. We're doing our best to improve and increase our communication. And one of the big ways that we do that is through media.
Yes. Yeah. So if you looked up media director and marketing director, they are two different heads, to where one is focused a lot on content. One is focused a lot on organizational, functional, and statistical or data-tical.
Yeah. Analytical.
Analytical parts of things. So which we need. We need to figure out. My take on it is we need to figure out when our videos, we put it out and we put money against them, we need someone that can do a deep dive and figure out, yes, that video is doing good. Yes, that demographic is who we need to push toward. This is who we need to advertise to. This is the kind of videos we should make. And then allow me to not worry about that and say, okay, this is the content we're creating. Mm-hmm. Hey, you guys, let's do this type of content. So
yeah, and that's something, the data analytics, that sort of stuff, Bobby has done well at that. But one thing that he has that a lot of people don't have, and that I think he has in spades, is just his creative prowess, right? As a creative, Bobby can do a lot of things that a lot of people just can't do. And so, yeah, kind of some of the thinking, that's cool. Some of the thinking for us is is to allow Bobby to focus more on that creative stuff that he's so apt to do. And then I'll do some of the data and analytics and all that. So I've been researching and studying up as quickly as I can.
What kind of disc golf questions you got for us, YouTubers? Let us know. Let's head over to Fantasy Disc Golf for Skip Ace. As we talked last time, these are Eric's choices. How well do you think you did, Eric?
I would have done better if the guys I picked played better. Like they told me they were going to.
Did you call them ahead of time?
Like yes. You had discussed with them, huh?
No pressure.
I called them, and they said, yeah, dude, I'm doing good this week.
We actually didn't do too bad. We ranked 83.
That's not bad.
Usually we're in the hundreds.
Boom roasted.
So you got them there. So you picked Paul McBeth, which got you the big 250.
No brainer.
Adam Hames got you only 70. Yeah. Brinchter got you 150. Albert Tam got you 140.
Yeah, we had Clemens on there.
I did have took Clemens him off. And we took Clemens off.
That would have been a good one to have.
Yeah. Oh, yeah, because he plays second, right?
Second place.
Oh, wow. Paige Pierce didn't do quite as well as Paige Pierce usually does. She got 180 points.
But it's hard. Fourth, yeah. Yeah, that's a pick you have to pick every week.
I think so, sure. Yeah.
Erica Johnson hurt us and got negative 55, took 55 points away. Darn. So 735 points to the 83 people, or I'm sorry, 82 places ranked better than us. So let's go to our random number generator.
Seven.
Plug in our numbers.
51,000.
And generate number 56.
You were close.
Really close.
56. I got to go to the next page. Number 56 is...
John.
Gruden.
Rich McClelland.
Chunky. Oh.
Rich McClelland, if you are logged into your Skip Ace, take a screenshot and email it to Bobby at dynamicdisc.com, and I'll get you a disc from my goody stash sent out to you.
Goody, goody, good, good.
So thank you guys so much for... How many events do we have left? Just the finale?
I don't know.
Is it just the finales left?
Do they do picks for?
Yeah.
No, they still have...
A lot of picks left, right?
USDGC, Hall of Fame.
Oh, my bad,
There's plenty of
It's not just Pro Tour, right? It's like majors and...
Does it show? Let's see. Picks. What's coming up next on Fantasy? Oh, the Ed Hedrick.
Steady Ed Hedrick, DNT.
That's not until October 11th, so we have some time until we have to pick that.
Bobby, you can cat on the board wants to correct your pronunciation. They said it's Hamas, not Hames.
I knew that.
And then they said,
I just assumed that's why we did so bad this week, because Bobby put the wrong guy in.
And then they said, noobs.
What's so. Noobs?
That's just, they're calling us noobs.
Oh.
So.
Okay.
Thanks for that. But I do have a question, unless you've got a little bit more to say about Fantasy Disc Golf.
No.
Okay. Ace Run Productions on the board says, does Paige Pierce getting to a rating of 1,000 seem more plausible by the end of next year?
By the end of next year?
I would
year?
Say not by the end of next year, but I could see it happening.
Yep, same. It's certainly possible. Mm-hmm. And this is going to be a John Madden sort of moment. She has the best chance to do it because she's only 20 points away.
Yeah.
The big thing that she's going to have to do is replace those, 920, 930, 940 rated rounds with 1,000 rated rounds.
And when you get to that level at your highest rating ever, another 20 points is not an easy task.
Yeah.
Doing just
it sounds
year.
And when you put it like this, it's like. You need to average 2 strokes better around.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. I mean, that sounds easy enough, but gosh, it's just not.
Yeah, it's tough.
Yeah. I mean, there are, at any given time, there are usually fewer than 200 1,000 rated players in the world. Usually it's around 200. So in order for Paige,
do you think she would get there quicker if she just played MPO?
I don't think so.
Because, I mean, they play different courses each week.
Sometimes they play different courses. Sometimes
Most
they play.
Most of the time they do.
Yeah. It's
and
entirely
by different
possible.
Courses, I'm talking even shorter tees. That's a different course.
All it takes is for one tee to be shorter for it to be considered a different course. It would probably help. She would have to. Joel Freeman said something online that I think is accurate, that if she were to only compete in MPO, she probably wouldn't be quite as driven because she wouldn't be on lead card nearly as often, challenging for the win.
True.
It would just really be competing against herself at that point.
Yeah.
And I mean, I could see, as somebody who goes to tournaments who is not going to be on the lead card very often, I think it's hard for me to be as focused as I possibly can be
Without a gallery.
Or with the knowledge that, like, I'm not really going to win this tournament. I would have to go shoot the best golf I've ever shot, plus a little bit, three that times in a row to win. You know what I mean?
Yep.
So, yeah, ratings-wise, it might get her closer, but I think it'd probably be a wash in the focus that she'd have to increase. So, but, I mean, she's got the best shot to do it. She certainly has the game to do it. She can throw more than 450. Her putt has looked really good this year.
Mm-hmm.
And that's been one of her bugaboos is missing short putts. And right now she's definitely not doing that.
True.
Anyway, good question, Ace Run. Gabe asks, what kind of jacket do you guys use when the weather gets colder?
My house.
Disc golf. Yeah.
Hoodie for life.
Yeah. I like hoodies.
No, hoodies are good.
If it doesn't have pockets in the front though, like get out.
Yeah. Yeah.
Not interested. Super not interested. If it does have pockets, extremely interested.
Yeah.
Is that because you have to accessorize?
Yes. Got to put stuff in the pockets.
Yeah.
Like my hands, because they're cold.
True.
What other questions you guys got? Come on now. This is the after show show. Anything. We'll talk about anything.
Yeah. Pat makes a good point, too. Shay and I were talking about this a little last night. The better that you get, the harder it is to get a stroke better per round. That's 100% true.
That's why it's so hard for me to get 850.
Yes, because the better you get, you know, you have to now you have to shave 3.5 strokes a round. Where do you even find those?
I know.
Especially when you don't even play.
I know. It's hard.
Especially when you're not on the course at all. Sorry about that. That's something too, what you're saying. The gap between 960 and 980 is easier to cover than the gap between 980 and 1,000.
Agreed.
And obviously, that holds true as you move up from there as well. Jimmy Sturgis, this is a good question for you now, Eric McCabe.
What's up?
Because we just talked about some job changes. So Jimmy asks, as an AM player, how do you get a sponsor?
You don't.
Rip. You hate to see it, but
you're out.
The man
no,
told you.
I think if you look at our team, I would say majority of the players are.
We got quite a few AMs.
Quite a few AMs on there, but. For us, I can't speak for, like, say, other companies, but for us, it's all about what are you doing for disc golf in your area? How are you growing the sport in your area? Are you running tournaments? Are you running clinics? Are you throwing our brand right now? You know, are you promoting dynamic discs in your area? That kind of stuff is kind of the stuff that we kind of look for.
Yes.
In sponsorship.
Yeah. I would also say this is something that Bobby has said before. When people come to us with ideas of what they could do if we would sponsor them, like they'll say, you know, I could go on the road to all these big tournaments and compete really well if you would just sponsor me. That's not really how it works. In general, disc golf is at a point, and I think our company is at a point where you kind of have to establish yourself and prove that whatever investment a company is going to make in you is a worthwhile investment. Like, what can you provide as a return on that investment?
Yeah.
Once, if it's much easier to come to a company and say, this is what I'm already doing, rather than this is what I'm going to do.
Right.
Yeah, exactly.
So,
let's see. Johnny V had a good question for me. Maybe y'all can put in your thoughts too.
Interested.
Mike has a good one. New iPhone or Apple Watch? Both. Easy. Okay, Bobby. Here's from Johnny V. And I'd like to see Johnny V.
Let's be serious.
Respond.
The new watch and then get the phone next time. Right? Isn't that what he said?
I'm going
to
get...
What is it? Bobby, you don't have to answer that. Which one? Doc, what do you mean? Spin TV is doing a good lead card post. What does Doc Sensei?
It's because of what Johnny V asked you.
Oh, okay. Okay, Bobby, being a media director, what are your thoughts on Joman is not covering USDGC this year? They're going in-house with Spin TV.
This isn't the first time they've done that, right?
I don't know the history on that, to be honest with you.
I think that's right.
Let's see.
But Jomez was out there last year.
Yeah. I mean, like the year before, maybe. Yeah. Or something. I don't know. I know Spin TV has done some stuff for them in the past.
Yeah. Go ahead, Bobby.
I'm mixed on this because I get what they're trying. I get, this is my perspective, what I think's happening is that the in-house thing is that Jomez is proving that there are viewers that want to watch disc golf, quality disc golf production and things, right? Or media, right? They're proving that. 150,000 subscribers, they're doing amazing. They are great. They're wonderful, and they're awesome at what they do. They're very talented. So one part of me says that I can see where a company would want to bring stuff in-house so that they could benefit off the media from disc golf, right? And they can have control over whose ads you see. And when those eyes are on those videos, whose ads, whose brand you see, I get that. But then the other part of me says, well, wait a minute, if I want to get my stuff in front of my event, in front of the most eyes, then why not go to the people that are getting the most eyes on the product, which is going to be Jomez. So I'm a little mixed on it. I can see both sides. If it came down to it, I would pick for Glassbone Open. I will not tell you because that is my own opinion that is internally discussed.
Internal.
Because anyway, so that's my thinking is that, I mean, what do you guys, yeah. I mean, right? I mean, you want your 150,000 subscribers, they're just going to keep growing.
Yes.
So you would think you would want to take advantage of their audience.
I don't think they care.
They who?
Innova.
Oh, yeah.
I don't think that I don't think they're trying to sell people to come watch the USCGC and get views that way. They could all do it in-house for so much cheaper, for free, essentially.
Right.
Control their ads.
They control the ads.
People are going to watch it.
Right. That's the other side of the coin for me.
Yeah. And be able to potentially pay the player more.
Right.
But I don't know.
I don't know.
Johnny V said that they're doing live?
No.
Not that Johnny V's doing live. I thought
he said some Fulcrum. I think he was guessing that Fulcrum was supposed
to be asked to do it. I think they backed out.
I don't know if there's not
live coverage again at USCGC?
I don't think so.
I haven't heard the latest on it.
Yeah, I don't know
either. Why would you not do live? I think that's a bigger debate than who you're doing for post-production.
I agree.
Why wouldn't you do live?
I totally agree.
Here's the big question that Johnny V asked. Would you ever consider bringing the GBO in-house with your media guys?
We're doing it next year. Sorry, guys.
Well, no, that's not anything official.
I'm just kidding.
I mean, that's... I'm not going to lie. I can't.
It's not like you haven't thought about it.
I've thought about it. I have thought about it. I'll just put it that way.
We're actually going to not be Smashbox either, right? It's going to be me out there with my cell phone.
Oh, okay. He said...
Yeah, Fulcrum is doing live.
Yeah, he said Smashbox isn't doing live.
I knew that, but who's that?
Fulcrum, they did it last year, didn't they?
It was like
a show.
But it was just like hole 17, right?
Something like that. It wasn't a full-on full tournament coverage. Yeah. I don't believe so.
Fulcrum is an established ultimate coverage group.
Interesting.
So, yeah.
I think I remember a little bit of that last year.
But it was just a whole 17 live show. And I'm hoping. Yeah, that's exactly
where they're in the booth, right?
Yes. I'm hoping that it's a shot for shot, Jamie.
Jamie, yeah.
I'm hoping that it's shot for shot this year. I would love to watch that live.
I would love that. So, I mean, who doesn't like live video? Especially for arguably one of the biggest events of our year.
Yeah. I mean, I look forward to it for sure.
The live production definitely could use some tightening up. That's nothing against Smashbox. They're doing what they can with the technology and the resources they. And I would say that probably Johnny V would say the same thing, is that live coverage could be used tightening up as far as.
And I'm not disagreeing with
that. Sure. I'm just I know that that's kind of the argument some people say is they love the post-production format.
Well, of course,
because
that's why you get best of both worlds when you do both.
But you cannot beat the feeling of live when you don't know who's going to win and you're watching it as it happens.
Exactly.
There's no substitution for that.
Yeah.
At all.
Much more captive audience.
Remember when they did Dots? Does anybody remember that?
Yes.
That was so funny.
Yes.
Think about that now. That technology now.
Yes.
Bobby has no idea what we're talking about, probably. Do you remember Dots?
Absolutely, I remember.
Isn't that
Dots.
Crazy?
Yes.
Let's do Dots for this. Isn't that crazy to think? I think it's
awesome that they did that, but I remember at the time thinking, there's got to be more. There's got to be more, which I knew there would be. But it was cool. It was cool when they came out with it.
All right. Pat says, have you noticed any particular personality traits on or off the course that tend to be present amongst all top-tier players? He didn't say all, but I said that. Personality traits that are common amongst top tier players.
I would, for me, an observation I think I see is that everybody loves that disc golf feels like a family.
Yeah, right.
And they do. And I know that the Memorial is usually a time where we always say it feels like you're coming back to a family. You're people you haven't seen in months and stuff like that that you're familiar with because you see them on the road and touring. But even then, they are true competitors.
Yeah.
They want to win. They all want to win. And when and even though we're all friendly on the they're all friendly on the tee pad and the courses, when it comes down to it, they're out to win.
Yep.
And I would see that as a trade. I see.
Yeah, yeah. I would say the top people, they hate losing, right? There's not one person who finishes in the top 10 every week who goes into it thinking, you know, if I finish top 10, that'll be pretty good. They all think I'm going to win. I have the skills to win. If I execute my game plan, I'm going to win.
Right.
And that sort of determination, yeah, I think that's common through those top few players.
Someone said, Bobby, I saw you and your pet dog at the DD store on Saturday. It was a Great American Market. We were stopping in the cool off.
Nice.
It was hot. I was wondering how you feel about strangers petting your dog. Sebastian loves the attention. I'm okay with it. I would say just for the safety of everybody, it might be a good idea to ask so that maybe Sebastian is ready for it. Although he's never, ever snipped at anybody.
Yeah.
You know, it's funny you say that. Ralph, there's only been one person ever that he like growled at and didn't like.
I can't wait to hear who that would be.
Ron Converse.
Ah,
really?
Fear the hat.
It must have been the hat coming in. It was in the evening when he stayed at my house one time years ago, and Ralph just went off.
He's not having
it. As soon as he came in? Or
as soon as he walked in the door.
Oh, man, I didn't know.
Just started barking at him. Like, he wouldn't do anything, but he was just barking at him. Like,
this guy probably reads the wind well. I'm going to growl at him.
Yeah.
You funny. A witch doctor. Rah, rah, rah.
The only person.
Now, Sebastian barks at people when they come into the house and stuff, but if you approach him to pet him, he's...
No, it was a little different than that. Like, Ralph, nothing. He'll like, attack you as far as, like, excited to see you.
Right.
But not barking.
Yeah.
Like, Ron Conn is the only person he's ever barked at.
Chances of Paul McBeth getting the major sweep again this year?
I would say...
He's playing pretty darn well.
Yeah.
It's hard to argue with. Sean up there says, I feel like USDGC is becoming more prestigious than Worlds. Agree or disagree? It's a disagree for me.
I agree.
I think it is.
I agree with you.
Yes.
I disagree with both of you.
I think that you are the worst. No, I don't actually think that. They're just different. They're different. Eric has said it like this before, and I agree. I would rather be called a world champion than a U.S. champion. And maybe that's just part of the nomenclature or whatever. That's fine. But I think more companies, more people place more emphasis on the world championship 100%. Than the U.S. championship.
Absolutely, they do.
And it's awesome. If given the option to win one or never win any, obviously I'm going to choose either one. I don't care. But if I had to choose one, if I was guaranteed to win one or the other, I would pick Worlds.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, there's just something in the sound of it.
Same.
I don't know if it's just a thing, but there's just something in the sound of it when you say someone's a world champion as opposed to a United States champion, a U.S. Champion. Mm-hmm. I've heard that sentiment for years. That USGGC is more prestigious than Worlds. I don't know. It seems like that's like a battle or something. Earlier I said
one of the most prestigious. But
right.
I think a lot of it is because as a player, it's consistent because it's the same people running it every week in and week out, or year in and year out, I guess. And it's true. Like in the beginning when I was first playing USGGC, when I was first touring, that was the event that all the top players could go to and know we're getting paid. Yep. Like, I mean, back then I think it was like top 20, top 30 were taking home at least $1,000, which was big money back then.
Mm.
And it did. They treated you well. I mean, they had the ropes. I mean, everything about that event was amazing.
It feels like hallowed ground when you walk on.
Absolutely, it does.
It's really cool.
And with the World Championships, it moves every year.
Mm,
and it's somebody new running it. So, I mean, it's going to change from year to year on how people's perspective of how to run an event. But at the end of the day, the title is all that really matters. And I'd much rather have my world title than had have won a U.S. title back then.
Mm-hmm. Have they put the layout yet? Remember U.S.?
They're changing a couple of holes this year.
The caddy book goes out.
But they
always do something.
For the last few years, it's been like USGC is like a testing ground.
And that's an argument
things.
That I had as well, that people about it being the best event or the most prestigious event is, if that's the case, then why are we testing all these really obscure rules out, like the bunker rule, and confusing people on how to play a certain rule and getting approval from the PDGA to do some certain rules and play certain holes certain way. It just doesn't make sense to me on why you would do that.
Have they? But they're not doing that this year. They're keeping it pretty.
I mean, they're probably still using bunker rules and all that.
Yeah. Right, but they're not introducing anything brand new.
I don't not that I've heard, but yeah, it doesn't mean they're not doing
but,
it.
But I mean, the ratings don't even count there because they use rules that are experimental.
And well, like, not just that, it's the stroke and distance.
Yeah, on a couple of holes, yeah.
So that one's just for the prestige then.
Really?
I mean, it doesn't count towards your rating.
No,
your
like
NT points.
I think I averaged like
10-20
or 10-15 there last year, but none of them counted because that's.
And that's another. I mean, the ratings are going to be a little inflated at that event, a little higher because
it's hard.
Who's there?
Yeah, and it's freaking hard to stay in bounds. Sean makes a good point. He says USDGC is invite only. I do think that adds to the prestige of the event.
I agree.
At the same time, you would be hard pressed to go back in past years and find someone who finished in the top 30 at Worlds who didn't also qualify for USDGC. So, like, really, it's going to be the same field at the top. But I think that does bring some prestige
into
USDGC.
That being said, for a lot of those years that it was invite only, every single person who ran a qualifier event got one. Every state got one to give to whoever and however they wanted to give it to. So
that
there was
crazy.
Players out there that were sub 800 rated playing, like 800 rated players out there playing because they won a or didn't win. They were
awarded a spot,
a qualifier or a whatever you want to call it for a state coordinator. So
that being said, is Paige Pierce trying out again?
Trying out? You mean is she playing? Because she's qualified. I don't think she's playing.
Oh, okay.
There's only only been one female ever to cash at the USDGC.
Was that
Juliana
Corver.
That's what I thought.
The only one. And she killed it. She like finished top 30 or something.
How many spots can go there and qualify for it?
There's five spots on Monday.
Monday qualifying, five spots,
And how many people usually try out for that spot?
50, 40. 50?
Wow.
Yeah.
That's still a big pool.
I had to do that 1 year.
Well, and
I qualified on Monday. Yeah, I did.
Right. And
I was
a lot of the
first
people,
round out.
A
lot of pressure.
Which is awesome.
Oh, and it was crazy. Like, I didn't play. I hadn't been playing great that year, and I went out. And this was like 12 or 13, I think. 13 or 14, maybe. Because we were throwing I had our arsenal, because I remember I was throwing a forehand with a giant. But I played with Harold Duvall.
Forehand?
Mm-hmm. Get out. Well, on hole 17.
Okay.
Yeah. I played with Harold Duvall, who is tournament director / owner, Innova, all that good stuff. We played together that first round. And I was killing it. I was playing well. And then I was coming down the stretch thinking, you know, my score, if I go par to finish, that's probably good enough for last year. So I felt pretty confident in it, right? And hole 17, get up there, I throw a forehand, and it skips out the back OB. And I'm like, oh, great.
Then your head starts spinning.
Here we go. I mean, that next shot is the hardest shot of your life.
Yep.
Next shot, I threw another forehand.
Can attest.
And I aced it.
Easy three.
So I got a drop in. Well, not a drop in. I got a three because I aced from the tee. But and then went on to qualify by a couple strokes, I think.
Yeah,
like
easy
that,
way
but,
to go par.
Yeah.
Throw one OB.
Throw one
ace
OB,
it.
Ace, and then par 18.
Easy three, yeah. Yeah, that's... That's one experience I wish more people in disc golf could have, is standing on hole 17's tee when you have a decent round going.
Yes.
Because that's unlike anything I felt in disc golf ever. And I took an 8 my first round.
I've done
it
a lot. I've done that many, many years, and I've taken sevens. And when I first played USDGC the very first year, it was the easiest hole I've ever played in my life. It played alongside the water. The green itself was just a big circle. If you go back and watch the Climo.
When he picks up the basket.
Yeah,
and all
the
that.
Climo Schultz playoff, that hole they played it in there. And it was the easiest little dump shot ever. And then they moved it up top, and it got so much more challenging. And I also played the USDGC the year that it was stroke and distance.
Oh, my gosh. No,
and
thanks.
That was just a mental nightmare.
Yes.
I mean, every single hole, Bobby, stroke and distance. Every single throw, no
you
matter
go
where
be off
you
the
throw
tee,
be,
re-tee.
You're rethrown from where you threw from no matter what the stroke penalty. And people were taking like 20s and 25s
on good
holes.
Players, mind you.
It was nuts.
Forget that.
Yeah.
It was crazy.
Yeah.
What a great time.
Tony.
So just really briefly, talking back about Monday qualifying, usually all it takes to qualify is like one or two under.
A couple under.
Which sounds easy, like, go shoot one or two under, but there's just danger around every corner there. As soon as you sleep on a hole,
you can never rest.
Exactly. Yeah. That's what I'm talking about going into 17. I was four under and feeling fantastic about my round. I played well, kept the disc in bounds, and skipped out the back, hit the top of the hay bales with my second and stayed out. and it launched it out the back on the third. Easy eight. Went from 4 under to 1 over just like that.
Tony has an interesting question. He says, y'all three have eyewear, so here's the question. Do you feel there's a difference in your play when your eyewear is dirty versus clean? This eyewear is just my reading glasses because I'm getting old and your eyes don't, your muscles don't work as well for close-up. So I have to wear reading glasses for the computer. Otherwise, I wear contacts.
Which is still eyewear, technically.
Right, but they don't get dirty like a pair of glasses.
I've thought about getting eye contacts.
You should get nose contacts.
Okay, I was going to say, what other kind of contacts are there that I could try out? I've thought about getting contacts. I tried them in high school, and they did not mesh with my eyes well for some reason.
How long ago was that?
Quite a while, like 15 years.
Oh, they've improved quite a bit.
Yeah.
I've never had. I'd like to try them.
Had you ever tried?
No.
You've never tried to put one in your eye?
I haven't had glasses that long, though. Like, when I toured and played on the road, I didn't have glasses then.
Like, I've gotten so used to my glasses now that it would be really weird.
Right.
But at the same time, like, yeah, it does suck to have to clean them off. Or, like, you know, we've been playing pickleball lately. Pickleball, by the way. So much fun. Bobby and I have been shredding.
It is.
Maybe
fun.
Not shredding, but we've been trying really hard. But, yeah, my glasses always get sweaty. Yeah. So I have to wipe my face off every couple of points. And
also, like, if you ever see me, like, inside or something, taking a picture of somebody and have sunglasses on, that's because those are prescription sunglasses.
The only prescription that you've got at the time.
Yeah.
Yes, I've had
that. And that's why.
Too.
I do want to, yeah. Maybe we should all get LASIK together.
I have contacts,
dude,
and I'm perfectly
fine. I've thought about getting LASIK.
Yeah.
It's expensive, though.
It's scary.
Yeah.
Just don't redo the bathroom. Just
sometimes. Yeah, there you go. Yeah, we could replace that
and
several thousand dollar expense with this.
Then you'll be able to see what's wrong with the bathroom.
Yeah. Ah, what was I thinking? Yeah, I don't know. I go back and forth about it.
I think I'll get contacts at some point.
Yeah, I probably will too. But then, like, my face is going
to
look so weird.
Yeah.
Look how weird. Hold on.
Just for a couple days.
Oh my gosh. Look how weird this is.
Ooh, that indent on your nose would have to go away for a little bit. Or
yeah. Well, and I've got this permanent tan here. Look at this thing.
I mean, it would look weird, but, like, I mean, I've been wearing contacts maybe like
8 years,
maybe a long time, maybe 10 years. But even before then, I had glasses, and you just had that. People just got used to it, and they started to know you.
I've worn glasses every day for probably the last 12 years.
They suck.
Maybe a little bit shorter than that.
What's really bad is when you're in a really cold car, and then you get out, and it's hot.
Oh,
and then it's like
the absolute worst.
Can't even see anything.
Yeah.
I feel like Doug Bierkus trying to walk to
the
door.
Dude, Sean has a great idea. He says, have an optometrist sponsor the show so you can get free LASIK.
Yeah.
Look, Mr. Optometrist, wherever you are, or Mrs. Optometrist, it's 2019.
it's 2019.
If you would like
for women to get optometrists.
Yeah, that's right. That's right. No. If you would like to sponsor the show, we will give you unlimited pre-roll and mid-roll ads in this show for LASIK. That's a lifetime offer.
Is that six eyes or is it
lifetime offer? That's
like
that's for
all of us?
That's for six eyes.
All three of us.
Yeah.
That's for six eyes. Minimum four eyes. Maximum six eyes. Depends on what Bobby wants to do. So if you're out
that's
there,
true. So maybe
Mr. or Mrs. Optometrist or Miss Optometrist. Maybe you're not married yet. That's fine.
Who's the pickleball doubles champs of the world? Oh, us? No, I don't think.
No,
so.
No, definitely not. But hey, we might go to a tournament this weekend to watch some people play pickleball in Wichita because they're really good, and
we should wait about 6 months and then go to Torchy's.
I'm
interested. Because they're getting the Torchy's there.
Yeah,
yes.
You should go then too.
I mean, we will.
Yeah, I've gotten to the point where I really like my glasses, but it would also be nice to not have to worry about them. Although, like, I can see fine right now without. I can see everything I need to. However, if I don't have corrective lenses of some type for a while, my brain will stop using my left eye completely, and it would become a lazy eye. And I'm not trying to play that game.
Really?
Yeah, it's a condition called amblyopia. I found out. I mean, that's what makes people develop lazy eyes is when your brain uses one eye more than the other. This eye is nearly perfect, right? But this eye, when I went to get my eyes checked when I was much younger, they covered up my left eye. I read all the stuff. It covered up my right eye, and I said, that's not fair. You're covering up both eyes because my brain was already not using that eye because it was weaker than the other one. So that's what makes people develop lazy eyes. So since then, I've had glasses of some type on and off for a long time.
And what's it called? Ambly-ambly?
Amblyopia.
Amblyopia?
Amblyopia.
Like Antioclea?
Amblyopia. I did see a comment earlier, when are we going to get the when are we going to get the get Bobby to pronounce words portion of the show? We need to add that to the Google form.
The Amblyopia Open.
Sean, I could throw without glasses, but if I take them off and then throw and then like the next few minutes are going to be really rough. If I take them off like an hour before I go play, I would be fine because my eyes have a little bit of time to adjust.
Whoa, Chaser has neocorneal vascularization.
Vascularization. Stuck with glasses for life. Yeah, I'm getting to that point where if I do have glasses for life, whatever. Mr. Drew says Robert gets a marketing job and immediately uses it to get things for himself. Mr. Drew, what's the point of having a marketing job if you're not trying for that? Okay.
It's true.
That's what we're here for. So, Mr. or Mrs. or Miss Optometrist, if you're listening to the show, let's talk about LASIK or free contacts or free glasses.
What would you
we would shout you out so often. Come on, man.
What would you rather have, a confident putt or a weak putt? Is that a question?
I think I'll have a confident putt. Thank you.
You have to give us some context, Jake and Whale. Jack and
Whale. Yeah. That's pretty much all our questions.
It seems like confident putt would be the most obvious answer.
Should you use a drop putt if you're out of your putting range? Yeah, I mean, most of the time, if I'm outside where I feel like I can give a reasonable run at the basket, I'll just kind of jump put it up under there somewhere. Like, not even try to make it, just try and land it somewhere close. That's what I do.
Gotcha. All right, we're losing watchers, viewers, so we're going to go ahead and end this.
But if you haven't done so already, will you subscribe to the YouTube channel, please? We're trying to get to 50,000, and along the way, we want to give you some things.
We are on our road to 50,000 subscribers. Go to dynamicdiscs.com/road to 50K to get more information and to enter in your name. You got to help us get us to the 1,000 subscriber milestone so we can start giving stuff away.
Swerve.
Ice cream and cake Swerve. Or ice cream cake?
Ice cream on cake. Top of cake.
Ice cream and cake is correct. That'll be the end of the episode. Thank you.
Thank you guys so much. We will see you on the next show.
Okay, bye. 5 stars.